This call is now being recorded.
Good morning, friends. Let's continue our discussion on valuation of supply of goods and services under Goods and Services Tax Act. Okay, so we are going to talk elaboratively about the valuation rules of goods and the supply of goods and services under GST. So here in this particular slide, we can see that there are some rules like rule 1, rule 2, rule 3, rule 4, rule 5, rule 6, so on and so forth. So what is rule number 1 as far as valuation rules of supply of goods and services under GST? So rule number 1, the case is where the consideration is not wholly in money. So when the consideration towards the supply of goods and services is not wholly in money, then in such a case, what is the valuation rule speaks? So this is case 1. Case 2 is, or rule 2, or case 2 and the rule for it, where the supply is where the supply of goods and services is between distinct or related persons other than agent. In such a case, what is the valuation rule? So this is case 2. We are going to look at the valuation rules separately. Let's first identify the different cases. The third case is when the supply is made or received through an agent. So in this case, this is the valuation rule. So the first case is when the goods supplied or services supplied, consideration is not only in money. Okay, in the third case, when the supply is made or received, supply of goods or services are made or received through an agent. So this is the valuation rule in case of a situation like this, that is open market value or 90% of the price charged by the recipient who is unrelated customer. Okay, we'll see some more examples as we move into the discussion. Rule number 4, valuation of a value of supply based on cost. So rule number 4 and other rules. There are other rules also which we are going to talk about. These are in particular about services. This is the valuation rule in respect of certain supplies, and this is also in case of certain supplies. This in particular is about the goods, supply of goods. Okay, so basically, as far as supply of goods are concerned and its valuation is concerned, the headings are, the cases are basically divided into 5. Case 1, situation 1, you can take it as situation. Situation 1, situation 2, situation 3, situation 4, and situation 5. If these are the situations you have in front of you and you are supposed asked to find out the valuation of such supplies under situation 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5, then what are the valuation rules for individual situations? So the first situation is the supplier and the recipient of the supply are unrelated persons or not related to each other. That is, the supplier and the recipient are not related to each other, and for them the price is the sole consideration. In particular, for the supplier, he is concerned about the consideration. Okay, this is situation 1. In such a case, what is the valuation rule speaks about? How do you evaluate or find out the valuation under such circumstances where the supply is in between related unrelated persons and price is the sole consideration? Number 2 is taxable value when consideration is not wholly in money, partly something is. Number 3, in such a case, what should be the rule? Number 3, valuation of supply between two related, so it's a supply of service and this supply of goods and service, two related parties, they are related to each other. Okay, so how to find out the valuation of such supply of goods? Number three is when the value of goods, when the value of supply of goods are made or received through an agent. Okay, we'll take up separately all these four instances and in other specified cases, what is the valuation rule speaks about. So let's take the first valuation rule. And we'll find out what is the answer to it. Let's pick the answer to it. How do you find out the value of such taxable supply of goods? So the first is the supplier and the recipient, that is the buyer and seller, or who are the people who are transacting in the goods, are not related to each other, and for them the price is the sole consideration. Okay, in such a case the valuation rule is transaction value at which this particular transaction is carried out. For example, Mr. X goes to a showroom of, for example, Vijay Sales, okay, and purchases a laptop for 1 lakh rupees. So first and foremost, we have to identify whether the transaction is between a related party or unrelated party, and from this we can identify that X doesn't have anything as far as relation is concerned with Vijay Sales, and these two are independent persons, and between them price is the sole consideration. In such a case where this is a situation where the supplier and the recipient of the goods are both unrelated to each other, and between them price is the sole consideration, then the transaction value is the value as far as valuation of goods are concerned. So transaction value becomes the value of goods. So transaction value is the price actually. Now why we need transaction value? Transaction value is the price actually paid or payable for such supply of goods and services. I spoke about that. So for this kind of a goods or services, what is the price paid or payable by X to Vijay Sales? That is called as a transaction value. And what are the conditions? There are two following conditions which have to be fulfilled that this particular transaction comes on case one, and this one is one, the supplier and the recipient can relate each other and price is the sole consideration. So the second condition is, the first condition is the price and the recipient are not related to each other. The supplier and the recipient of goods or services are not related to each other. Number one. Number two, price is a sole consideration for such supply. And price is a sole consideration for such supply. Okay. So if these two conditions are fulfilled, then transaction value is the value that we have to consider for levying GST. So in this case, we have identified that 1 lakh rupees is the 1 lakh rupees is the transaction value, and hence we have to levy tax on this one. Okay, on this 1 lakh rupees. Hope you have understood this one. So in many of the cases we see that transaction value is the price which is paid by the recipient of goods to the supplier of goods. Okay, and for in between them the sole consideration is the price itself. Okay, so hope this particular point is to next one is hope you have understood this particular point. Well, let's take up one more example. Let's carry forward our discussion as far as valuation of taxable supplies are concerned. Now, so this is understood. If I'm okay, I'm sure that you have understood it. So let's take this further. Let's discussion further and take next particular instance. So let's take some more points under one. So what do you mean by related parties? So your question will arise in your mind, sir, how can I identify whether the transaction is between a related party or not? How can I identify? To identify the transaction, that is the supply of goods and service between two unrelated person or not, we have to identify we have to find out the definition, or we have to have a thorough understanding about related party. Now, related party, I will give you some examples, like employer and employee are in transaction. The goods have been, or supply of goods and services are between a employer and employee. For example, Tata Motors is there, and employee of Tata Motors is there. Now, Tata Motors is selling to its employee whatever product they are manufacturing, for example, a passenger car. Certainly, Tata Motors is expected, by virtue of this particular relationship between the buyer and the seller, that is the recipient and the supplier of goods, Tata Motors can charge less than what it normally charged to outsiders. So outsiders, it might have charged 5 lakh rupees per car, but in this case, because of the virtue of relationship between the buyer and seller, it will charge only 3 lakh rupees. So they are related to each other. That is the reason they are charging less than what it is. It was charging for the normal unrelated people. In the same way, such person or officers are directors of one another's business. For example, Mr. X is a director in X company, okay, and Mr. X is director in Y company also. Okay, now in both the companies there are directors. He's a director, and if he's purchasing goods from this company, so it's a natural that it is going to this company is going to sell at a less price than what it is supposed it was collecting from the customers. So he's a related party. So there are so many examples as far as related parties are concerned. So I will not go to what do you mean by related party. It's left to you to take up this for your own understanding. Okay. Now, very important, this particular slide which has a lot of information is very, very important. What are the cost items which should be included in the transaction value, and what are the cost items which should not be included in the transaction value or to arrive at the transaction value. Now, before I go into the explanation part, I will give you a small example. For example, Mr. X and Tata Motors is there, and they are unrelated to each other. They are unrelated to each other because both are private parties. They have nothing to do. They are independent. And between them, there is a transaction of a supply of goods from Tata Motors to Mr. X. And assuming that they are selling a passenger car. Now, in this case, Tata Motors is supplying these goods to Mr. X at 5 lakh rupees. So this is the transaction value. This is the transaction value. That is the actual price paid by Mr. X or payable by Mr. X to Tata Motors. Now, how did we arrive that this is the transaction value? Because certain costs are incurred by Tata Motors, and after totaling all this cost, they will add an element of profit to that cost to arrive at the selling price, and that selling price will become the transaction value. So what are the different costs which are incurred for manufacturing and selling this particular product to Mr. X will become the transaction value, and we add to this one element of profit. So what are these costs which are included? What are the costs which are included in this 5 lakh rupees along with profit? So if I look at them, these are the normal costs which are incurred by the manufacturer. One is a raw material cost, one is wage cost or labor cost, one is factory overheads, one is selling and distribution overheads, one is office and administration overheads. And to this, from this we'll come to know the total cost incurred for manufacturing, and the company or the supplier will add a element of profit to arrive at the selling price. So selling price is nothing but the transaction value. So to arrive at this transaction value, you should include all these items, but which is raw material cost, wage cost, that is labor cost, office and administration overheads, factory overheads, and selling and distribution overheads. So raw material, you know what is raw material. Raw material used for the manufacturing of the finished goods. Wages, you know, for the labor, we are going to pay labor cost or wages to whatever they have done for conversion of raw material into finished goods. Next one is factory overheads, means factory rent. Factory, there are so many people, they are working, to them we are paying salaries. Factory power cost, designing, installation, factory machine depreciation, and other expenses are incurred. Okay. In the same way, office and administration overheads, office rent, office people salary, personal salary, office electricity bill, office printing and stationery, office postage and telegram, and other stuff. And selling and distribution overheads, selling in selling sales department, there are so many people who are working, to whom we will pay salaries, we'll pay commission, we'll come out with advertisement, publicity expenditure, commission to salespeople, and many other expenditures. So from, if you add all these five items, you will get the total cost, and we will add to the net profit. That will become the that will become the selling price. That is the price at which this particular goods is likely to be sold to the end customer. So this particular selling price, which is eventually become transaction value, will include all the cost plus net profit. Okay, so this is clear to all of you, if I am correct. Now, what should be included in the transaction value? So let's take some of the items which should be included in transaction values, and what are the items which should be included or excluded from transaction value. Okay, so let's take one by one. So the first one, so I will skip this one because it doesn't have that much of information, but I will give 1-2 points here. Packing and commissioning, packing expenditure. If any cost is incurred for packing the end material to be supplied to the customer, that packing cost will be included in the transaction value, because that is the cost incurred by the supplier by the virtue of its sales. And it should, once you are selling the goods, it should be in proper packing condition. Okay, then only you will be able to sell the goods. So irrespective of whether the cost is incurred by the recipient or supplier, it doesn't make any difference till it is understood that this particular product to be sold should have an element of packing also. For example, cool drinks, there is a proper packing that should be done. For example, pharmaceutical industry, syrup has to be properly packed. Syrup has to be properly, what do you call, insert, the liquid has to be stored, poured in the bottle, and the bottle is a packing cost. So that without packing, you can't sell the syrup directly. So, okay. So packing is expenditure incurred by the buyer or supplier. It doesn't make any difference, but that will bring into picture the product. So packing should be included. Commission paid to the commissioning is to be included. Commission paid to the sales manager has to be included, without which you are not able to sell the goods. Interest incurred has to be included in the transaction value. Any costs which are relevant has to be included, like transportation cost has to be included. Transportation cost has to be included. Freight charges have to be included. Freight charges, insurance of the product before it is transported to the customer. We have to ensure that the goods which are transported has to be insured. So insurance also is to be included in the transaction value. And whatever are common sense expenditure or relevant expenditure to bring to the fore the product or services have to be included. So even, for example, you are paying some taxes on your business premises, that is the taxes we call it, or duties, that also should be included, because this is natural. For sure, it is natural that you are going to collect this expenditure from the customer through the sale of the product. So hope you have understood this particular point. Now let's take some more examples. Okay, let's take some more examples. For example, you are purchasing the first inclusion to the value of supply. That should be included in the transaction value is taxes, duties, and cesses and fees that are charged or levied under any law and all that stuff. Okay, I will not go into the details. For example, you are manufacturing a particular product, and for this you have to purchase some raw material, and in the process of purchasing of the raw material, some taxes are levied. Okay, we will not take into account all what are those taxes, but we assume that some taxes are levied, and subsequently we procure this raw material to convert into finished product. So this cost is of raw material includes all certain taxes, etc., etc. So that should be included in the transaction value, because that is a cost which has incurred for the manufacturing of the finished product. Number two inclusion in the transaction value is, look at this, any amount that the supplier is liable to pay in relation to such supply, but which has been incurred by the recipient of the supply and not included in the price or even though this expenditure has been incurred by the buyer, who is the recipient of the supply of such goods or services, even though that is not that supplier is liable to pay in relation to such supply. So in this case, the supplier is liable to pay in relation to such supply. Okay. For example, now let's take an example. Even though the expenditure is incurred by the recipient of the goods or services, it doesn't make any difference, but the supplier is liable to pay in relation to such supply. For example, some 50 two-wheelers are manufactured by Bajaj Auto, and it is sold to Nasik dealer. And Nasik dealer, what he does, he will come to his showroom and take the delivery of 50 two-wheelers by a truck. It is getting transported by to Nasik. Now, see, the end product should reach Nasik, irrespective of whether this guy spends or this guy spends, it doesn't make any difference. But as this is a cost which is relevant to the product, it has to be included in the transaction value. So look at the answer. If as per the purchase order, supplier has to incur transportation cost, but instead of the supplier, recipient of the goods paid the transportation cost, then the same should be included in the transaction value. Okay. So it doesn't make any difference. So see, please, there may be some complications in understanding whether to take a particular cost or not, but common sense at the end should prevail, and you have to consider whether it should be a particular cost should be included in the transaction value or not. See, please have patience. We will take up some numerical problems, and at that juncture, at that point, whatever doubts you have, you will be getting full clarity of your doubts. Now, another expenditure which should be included are incidental expenses, including commission and packaging. For example, a refrigerator is there. So refrigerator is sold by a company which is manufacturing refrigerator to a dealer. And how many refrigerators are sold? Some 100 are sold. Now, once you are selling this 100 refrigerators by the manufacturer, it is being sold to the dealer. The dealer should properly pack it. In a proper packing condition, it should reach the dealer. Okay, so that's the reason why, whether it is incurred by the dealer or refrigerator manufacturing company, doesn't make difference, but there is a cost which should be happening, and that's the reason it should be included in the transaction value. And even commission, for example, to sell this particular 100 units to the dealer, a broker is there, a commission agent is there, and through the commission agent or broker or agent, we are selling it to the dealer, and we are paying this amount on this particular transaction, a commission amount. So this commission amount also is an expenditure incurred by refrigerating manufacturing company, and that also should be included in the final product transaction value. Whether it is a secondary packing or a primary packing, it doesn't make any difference, but it should be included. But there are certain cases where only amortization of expenditure
packing expenditure is incurred. For example, crates used in case of software, soft drinks. Okay, so that is amortized. So a part of the expenditure towards the cost of crates will be included in the transaction value. Okay, so that is the point here. Any incidental expenditures can be some connected expenditure like freight charges, transportation charges, insurance, designing. For example, in heavy engineering, designing has to be done, installation has to be done, commissioning has to be done. So all these are relevant expenditures that should be included. Now, next point is another item which should be included in the transaction value is interest or late fee or penalty for delayed payment of any consideration for any supply. For example, Mr. X sells some amount of goods worth 15 lakh rupees to Mr. Y. Okay, now this is the transaction value. This is the transaction value, and on this we are going to levy GST. But what has happened? This guy has agreed to pay it within 30 days. If he doesn't pay within 30 days, then for the extra days what he is taking to make the payment, he will be charged per day 18%. And this amount is recovered, the over and above penalties or interest which is levied by Mr. X from Mr. Y will be included in the transaction value, because that also is the amount which has been recovered by the supplier. So hope this is also clear. Next point. So you can expect these questions in your examination. Next one is subsidies directly linked to the price, excluding subsidies provided by the central government or the state government. Subsidies directly linked to the price. For example, Mr. X is purchasing a laptop. Is purchasing a laptop from laptop company at 50,000 rupees. Okay, pay attention. It's very important example. Mr. X is purchasing a laptop from a laptop company or a retail outlet for 50,000 rupees. And there is one agency, which is a private agency. It is telling to Mr. X that, okay, you pay to him only 30,000 rupees. And the difference amount of 20,000 rupees is called a subsidy. That subsidy will be paid by the third party to this company. So in this case, please remember, if a private party is sponsoring a subsidy, then this is not the transaction value. This is the transaction value. The 20,000 rupees also should be taken. For example, in this case, 30,000 was paid by him, and the third party, a NGO, we can call it, a guy who is into social services, is paying 20,000 rupees. So in this case, not only 30,000 rupees is the transaction value, if a third party, a private party, is paying the amount of subsidy on behalf of Mr. X, then that should be included. That 20,000 will be also included. However, if this particular laptop is purchased by Mr. X at 30,000 rupees, and the difference 20,000 rupees is paid by the central government or state government to this company as a subsidy, then this 30,000 will be the transaction value, because the 20,000 is a subsidy provided by the central government or the state government, and it should not be included in the transaction value. In such a case, only 30,000 should be included, and that difference of 20,000 should not be included, because that is a subsidy provided by the central government or a state government or an appropriate government. Next one, discounts. So whenever you are purchasing some goods, for example, you purchase some 10 lakh goods. So you are going to pay him 10 lakh rupees. You are going to pay to the supplier 10 lakh rupees as consideration. But you will tell that, sir, please give me some 5% discount. So after 5% discount on this 10 lakh rupees, you will pay to him only 9 lakh 50,000 rupees. You will pay only 950,000 rupees. Now tell me whether GST should be levied on this one or this one. And primarily, the transaction value is only 950,000 rupees because this supplier is not receiving that 50,000 rupees because it is discount allowed by the supplier in the hands of the recipient. And this 10 lakh rupees should, from this 10 lakh rupees, which is the transaction value, you have to deduct discount, and discount should be excluded. It should not be included. Next, so this is the case as far as this particular point is concerned. The point is the supplier and the recipient of supply of goods or services are not related to each other, and price is the sole consideration. We will take up some problems today. Don't worry, wait. Okay, now second case. Now let's go into the second case. The second case is the value of supply of goods or services where the consideration is not wholly in money. The value of supply of goods and services are there, in which case the supply, the money towards supply, the consideration towards supply is not wholly in money and money only. Now what does it mean? I will give you a small example. With that example you will understand the situation. The example is, for example, Mr. X is purchasing a laptop. Mr. X is purchasing a laptop in a exchange offer. Now, what do you mean by exchange offer? Okay, let's go into this particular situation. So, what does this situation tells? For example, Mr. X is there. He's having a washing machine. Now, this washing machine is old, some 10 years old one. And now he wants to dispose it off and purchase a new laptop, new washing machine. Now, there is a agency, there is a company, or there is a business house which comes out with a exchange offer. That exchange offer is you bring your old washing machine to us, we will give you a new washing machine. So this guy, Mr. X, goes to showroom and gives his old washing machine plus some 20,000 rupees. Now this guy who is receiving this old washing machine plus 20,000 rupees will give to him a new washing machine. Now in this case, let me get an understanding. New washing machine. In this case, there is a doubt whether to levy GST on this one. So we are not sure. And if I am talking about, this should be charged on this one, but what is the value of the old one? We don't know. So in such a case, in this case, what is happening on top of it? The value of the supply of goods or services, the consideration to this value of supply of goods and services, the amount for this particular new machine is partly paid in cash, which is 20,000, and partly in the form of other, which is called as barter or exchange. So goods, which is the subject matter, is a washing machine. Washing machine is being sold, and I am getting as a supplier 20,000 rupees plus the old machine. Now, what is the transaction value? What is the value on which I am going to levy GST? Because ultimately our point is that we should find out what is the value of the supply, and on this supply we are going to charge GST. So we don't know what is the value of the supply. In such a case where there is a situation like this, where the value of goods or services, as I just now mentioned an example like this, where the consideration for the value of goods and supply of goods and services is not wholly in money and not and it is partly means what? Partly in money, partly in money, partly in money, and partly in otherwise. So to overcome this situation, we have examples like we have to take into account this following A, B, C, D rules. A, B, C, D rules. Now let's look at the A, B, C, D rules. Hear me? Okay. When the supply of goods, is partly in money, when the supply of goods or services is for consideration not wholly in money. So let's talk about this situation now. Okay. So the situation goes like this. So very, very important. And there are so many examples in real time, but let's take a small example. And so here the valuation rules, where the supply of goods or services is for consideration, not wholly in money. So just now we saw new washing machine was paid. The money for this consideration was paid in the form of old washing machine plus 20,000 rupees. So that is the meaning of it. So wholly in money, not wholly in money, means some part of this consideration will be the consideration for the new machine will be partly in cash and partly in kind. It can be an exchange offer or a barter. Barter bole to exchange offer. So in this such a situation, what is the value on which I am going to charge GST for the supply of goods or services? So you have to find out A, B, C, D, step 1, step 2, step 3, and step 4. Now what do you mean by step 1? So step 1 is the open market value. What do you mean by open market value? This particular new washing machine is there. There are so many companies which are dealing in this kind of machines. So what is the open market value of such supply? So if this machine is sold to a normal customer or a regular customer for which there is an open market, what is the value of it? So that will become the value of this particular transaction. Number one. Now, if this open market is not available, if this open market value of particular product is not available in the open, you can show that open market value of this washing machine is not available. If the open market value of this particular goods or services which are supplied is not available, then the total consideration in money and any such amount is equivalent to consideration not in money if such amount is supplied at the such amount is paid at the time of supply. So in this case, so what you have to do, the total sum of total consideration, so 20,000 rupees was the cash plus old machine now you can just say that the old machine may be around 15,000 rupees. So 20,000 plus 15,000 is equal to 35,000. So this becomes the value of the supply of such a good which for which the consideration is not paid wholly in money. So on this 35,000 rupees, this guy will be GST will be levied, for example 28% or 18% whatsoever. Now if the above condition is also not satisfied, we don't have any data as far as the old machine value is concerned, then we have to go to the third particular step. If this is not available, go to this step. If this step is not available, then go to this step. But you have to go in an order. First is open market value. Second one is if open market value is not available, then the total sum of money worth paid plus the value of the the other such amount converted. For example, how much can be valued? Now, if these two are available, we will go to third particular step. What is that particular step, third one? If the value of the supply cannot be determined in the above step two, if the value could not be determined from the step two, then the value of similar kind of goods of similar quality. Now, this is very important. Now, let's talk about this particular third step. If step one is not available, step two answer is not available, then we go to step three. Now, what is step three? Step three is the value of supply of goods or services are both of the like kind and quality. Now, this is, for example, the new machine which was sold was of this many liters of this much specification, or of this particular material of this particular kind or quality, and this particular goods should be sold at some 40,000 rupees. So similar kind of goods are sold at what price will become the basis, and you have to take into consideration the quality of the goods and the kind through which it has been, by which it has been manufactured. So similar kind of goods is the basic answer as far as C is concerned. Now, if you don't have answer from A, then to B. If you are not able to find out the value of the goods at B point, then go to C point. And C also, if this kind of goods are not available, this kind of quality, this kind of specific characterized goods are not available, then go to step four. Okay, then what is that step four? It shall be the sum total of consideration in money and such other money that is equivalent to consideration. Okay, we will take up some numerical problems at this, we will understand. Okay, then we will apply rule 30 or 31 of GST Act. So hope this is clear to you. Okay, so this is again summarized in the previous slide. I am summarizing. That is the situation where the value towards the supply of goods or services is the consideration of which is not wholly in money, partly in money, partly in cash, and partly in barter or exchange. Barter, exchange, something like that. So consideration partly in money and partly in kind. Kind means barter or exchange. Consideration wholly in kind. It can be, the, for example, bring your old, you want to purchase a new machine. Okay, you can purchase it. Bring 10 grams of gold. So in this case, there is no cash at all. There is no money at all. So this is purely on the basis of kind or exchange offer. Exchange offer is partly cash and partly goods or services. Okay. So in this case, we have to take into consideration the open market value. If more open market value is not available, as already told, second, you have to go to second step. That is sum total of the consideration money and some such money which is paid in consideration, not in money. Okay. Third step, goods or services of of similar kind or quality, how much, at what price they are sold. If you can't determine by either A, B, C, D, then determine it by application of rule 30 or rule 31 in that order only. So the fourth, rule four says that, so another one is, to the cost add 10% markup. This is the fourth condition. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay, the best judgment whatever you can take. So let's take a small example. Now this example will be there in your examination. Let's take up the example. The example goes like this. So this is a kind of, I can say, on the face of it, it is a exchange offer, I can say. Okay, exchange offer. Let's see. When a new phone is supplied for rupees 20,000 along with exchange of old phone. Now let's talk, what is this particular sentence telling? So Mr. X is having he's looking for a new phone, so he goes to a shop. He goes to a shop where mobiles are available. So he what the first is particular sentence, this one tells that he will carry with him old phone plus 20,000 rupees and he will give this to the shopkeeper and he will, this shopkeeper will give him a new mobile or new phone. Now the question arises, now on what the GST is going to be levied or what is the valuation of these goods? So already I told that these are the steps you have to follow. The steps are open market value or step 2, step 3 and step 4. So let's look at the solution to it. So here the first statement, if you look, is giving you the answer. The answer is the open market value. The open market value is 24,000. So you got the answer. So the first rule is you should look at the open market value. You should look at the open market value to find out the value of the supply. So you got a open market value. Yes, you got the open market value. Yes, you bought it, 24,000. So these goods are worth 24,000 rupees. That is the value of such goods, supply of such goods. So 24,000 rupees is the value of such goods supplied. And on this, not on this, okay? Because along this, you are even giving your old phone in place in lieu of a new phone. So the cost of this new phone in your hand is 24,000, or the value of such supply of goods is 24,000. So on this 24,000, GST will be levied. For example, 20%. So it is 4,800. So you have to pay another 4,800. That is 28,800 you will pay. Okay, that is the meaning. Okay, next one, next example. Let's take a second example. You can expect this question in your examination, in your MCQ. Next one, a laptop is supplied for 40,000 along with a bottle of a printer manufactured by the recipient. Okay, he is giving 40,000 rupees plus a printer and the and the value of the printer is known at the time of supply is 4,000. Okay, so the explanation to the problem is he is giving the person who wants to purchase a new laptop. He wants a new laptop. So he goes to the showroom, gives 40,000 rupees plus old printer. And this guy, who is the shopkeeper or the owner, he gives to him a laptop. Okay, now, so this is an exchange. So money, the value of the goods are paid partly in money and partly in kind. This is kind, this is money. So in this case, how to find out the value of the goods? So to find out the value of goods, you have to follow these steps. Open market value. Number two, money plus kind converted into money. Number three is similar kind of goods of like quality and quantity and kind, how much it is sold. If you don't have answer for 1, 2, 3, go to step 4. Now let's look at the answer. The answer is, in this case, the open market value is not given. Okay, so step 1 is not there. Step 1 is not there. Okay, then we have to go to step 2. What is step 2? Step 2 is money plus kind. Kind converted into money. Kind converted into money. Now, what is money here? This guy is paying towards this new laptop 40,000 rupees plus a printer. Now, printer is there. So, you have to find out the printer value. Now, the printer value is given in the problem. The value of such printer is 4,000 rupees at the time of supply. So 4,000 rupees is equal to, now 40,000 plus 4,000 is 44,000. So 44,000 is the value of the goods, value of a supply of goods. So on this 44,000, so he has to prepare a bill. Who? The shopkeeper will prepare a bill of 44,000. And on this, he will be levying GST of, for example, 20% or 28% whatsoever. So 44,000 plus 20% GST, for example, 8,800. So he will be paying 52,800, something like that. Okay. Hope this is clear. So the same way again I have put here. So open market value plus all that stuff. Now this is very important, and you can be expected. I will skip for the day and I will take it tomorrow. Now let's take up some problems on transaction value. Which have to be included and which are the ones which should not be included. Okay, Mr. Ramakant, manufacturer for the following manufacturer, provide the following information. He's Mr. Ramakant, who is the seller, and he's manufacturing some product, and he's giving the following information. Compute the value of the machine when Ramakant has to deliver this machine to a factory who is the recipient. So this guy is manufacturing some machine and is supplying to a particular factory. So what are the items which should be included and what are the items which should not be included? Now let's look the price at which Ramakant is selling to the factory is 2 lakhs. Number one. Number two, to these particular goods which are manufactured, which is a machine, there are some expenditures incurred like packing, designing, transportation, insurance, installation, and discount. So what should be done as far as these items are concerned? Packing charges, designing charges, transportation charges, insurance charges. Now you want to see, the buyer doesn't have familiarity as far as installation of the machine is concerned. So this guy along with the engineers go to the factory and install the machine. So for installing, there are some expenditures incurred by Ramakant, which is 10,000 rupees. And this Ramakant is giving 4% discount on cash payment on the price of the machine. That is 2 lakh rupees. Now the question is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. What should be excluded? What are the items that should be excluded? And what are the items which should be included? Let's look at the solution. So the price is 2 lakh rupees. Now to this, I have already told some expenses have to be included and some expenses have to be excluded. Some items have to be excluded. Okay, packing charges. So when you are manufacturing a machine, you have to properly pack it and transport it to the end customer. So these are the expenses which are going to take place. It is bound to take place and it should be included. So to this cost price, you have to add 20,000 rupees on the assumption that this is not included in this one. Next one is designing charges. Now, when you are manufacturing a machine like this, you have to properly design it as a manufacturer and then you have to supply it. And designing also is an expenditure which is likely to bound to take place and this should be included. So we are assuming that this was not included in this 2 lakh rupees. So I will include this 40,000 also. Next one is insurance. Now this machine is carried from a particular place to find Nagpur to Pune. So when it is transported, you have to go for insurance of the transport. You have to insure the product or the goods or the machines, and you have to pay for the transportation also. And whether this is incurred by the assessee, sorry, by the buyer or the seller, it doesn't make any difference, but it is bound to incur as a part of the supply of goods. So this 2,000 rupees, which is transportation charges, and 6,000 rupees, which is the freight charges, have to be included. Insurance, this is 2,000 is insurance and 6,000 is transportation charges. Now, Ramakant is going to the site of the recipient of the machine, and there along with the engineers he goes and install the machine. So there are some expenditures incurred by Ramakant. So 10,000 rupees. So this is assumed that it is not included, and as per rule it should be included. So we are including it. So to this 20,000 rupees, 2 lakh rupees, we have to add 20,000 rupees plus 40,000 rupees plus 2,000 rupees plus 6,000 rupees plus 10,000 rupees. So if you add all this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, these are 78,000 rupees, which will be added to 2 lakh rupees. The total value will become 2,78,000 rupees. So this is clear up to this stage. Hope so. Next one. Next one. What about the cash discount? This cash discount is on this 2 lakh rupees. So this is not received. This out of this 2 lakh rupees, he is giving a cash discount to the buyer to the tune of 8,000 rupees. So he is not going to receive this 2 lakh rupees, but he is going to receive only 1,92,000 rupees. So what did I do? I minused it or excluded it or decreased it. So this cash discount allowed to the customer should be deducted or excluded. So this 8,000 rupees also, like the these items which were added, these items, this particular item has to be minused or deducted. So 2,78,000 minus 8,000, I deduct from 2,78,000 8,000. The value will be, as far as the supply of goods, that is the machine, is 2,70,000 rupees. Is 2,70,000 rupees. So on this 2,70,000 rupees, he is going to prepare an invoice. The value, this is the transaction value, okay? This is called as a transaction value, is equal to 2,70,000 rupees, and we have to charge appropriate amount of GST, for example 18% on this transaction value. For example, for calculation purpose, I'm taking 20%, that is 54,000 rupees. So the buyer has to pay not only 2,70,000 but a GST of 20%, which is 54,000. So 3,24,000 check payment will be made by the buyer to the supplier. So hope you have understood these problems. Tomorrow I am going to take another set of problems. Another 5 problems will be discussed tomorrow. So join me, and at an appropriate time I will let you know. So join me. Thank you so much for